For those of you on Zoom, hello. Did I see that Angela is on Zoom? Hello, Angela. And Clive and Dave. All right. Why don't we get started? Okay. So is it broadcasting okay inside? Okay. Hey, Jeanette. Okay. Can folks hear me? Can folks hear me?
Not very well.
Not very well?
Well, people are talking.
Ah. Can folks inside the library hear me? Someone wave if you can hear me.
Hello.
Can they hear me? They can hear me? Okay. There we go. All right. Thank you all for your patience. We're working on some technology stuff here. Welcome. I'm thrilled that we're able to be here to celebrate Bob Cialdini and all his wonderful contributions to the department, our university, our science, and our broader community. It's really a special occasion. Thanks for coming. Some of you from far away, in person and on Zoom, ASU colleagues, former students, and fans within our profession, which I think reflects a lot about the great respect and gratitude Bob has garnered over many years. Bobette isn't here, unfortunately. Health stuff, we won't get into details. Bobette, if you're watching, hi, hope you're feeling better soon. Bobette has been Bob's similarly formidable partner for a good number of years. I would too, but this is about you and I'm trying to be nice. Okay. Thanks also to the social area for underwriting the food and drink today, and to Grace Jolly and Rob Ewing for putting all of this together, this event. And as usual, Grace does an incredible job, and the technology here has been a little complex, and so thank you, Rob, for that. You'll soon hear about Bob and his remarkable scholarly career with its far-reaching implications. Well, many of you also know, however, is that Bob and Bobette have long been stunningly generous and continue to be stunningly generous towards the department and ASU. Through their Leap Forward gift, their scholar awards for our graduate students and for our junior faculty, and many other gifts across the years. We wanted to say thank you in a way that would be lasting. We wanted to say thank you in a way that would be meaningful to Bob and Bobette. We wanted to say thank you in a way that captured, as best as we could, the fullness of Bob and all that he's contributed. And we wanted to say thank you in a way that might inspire and model and serve to both explicitly remind us and non-consciously activate in mind Bob's values and example for our faculty and students. Often thank yous for generosity take the form of names on rooms or halls or something of the like, and those are great. We thought about that. But a generic type of physical space didn't feel right. Our social psych labs are spread out across multiple buildings. And as Bob's longtime friend Rich Petty has mentioned, given Bob's famous field studies, we'd have to name, I don't know, a back stairwell, a parking garage, a hotel room, and that would be a bit strange. Moreover, names for physical spaces are static. They don't live. What does live is what Bob has dedicated his professional life to, the research enterprise, the ongoing search for understanding, for insight, for answers to vexing questions, for solutions to wicked problems. And so we're here today to name a somewhat more abstract space, the Social Psychology Research Enterprise here in the ASU Department of Psychology. The physical installation is here in the main hallway of the psych building, But the Robert B. Cialdini Social Psychology Laboratories is a conceptual space within which resides each of our living dynamic social psychology labs. I'll note that this installation is dynamic in other ways as well, and you'll see that for yourselves in a few minutes. Before turning the program over to Doug Kenrick, let me just provide a very brief bio of Bob for those of you who might not know. Bob grew up in Milwaukee, attended University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee as an undergrad, UNC Chapel Hill for his graduate studies, studied with Stanley Schachter as a postdoc at Columbia before joining the ASU Psych Department as an assistant professor in 1971. I'm not good at math, 51 years, maybe something like that. Okay, thanks. Some people here are pretty good at math. Pretty amazing. Bob's scientific contributions and the applications that have emerged from them are legendary in social influence, norms, pro-social behavior, full cycle, social science. And you'll hear more about those contributions in a moment. But for quick heuristic indicators of Bob's scientific impact, let me just note that Bob was in the very first class of ASU Regents professors, has been elected to the National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, has received the highest level Distinguished Scientific Contribution Awards from the Society, and these are the most important things in our places in our field. The Society for Personality and Social Psychology, the Society for Experimental Social Psychology, as well as the Society for Consumer Psychology. Bob's received honorary degrees from the University of Basel in Switzerland, the University of Social Sciences and Humanities in Poland, and Georgetown University. He's published over 200 articles, books, and reports. He's widely known for his book, Influence, now in his third edition with over, and Bobette would correct me on this if she were here, over 5 million copies. She'd say, oh no, Steve, it's up to 5.24 million copies right now. Over 30 languages.
It's over 40.
It's over 40, is it? Okay, it's over 40, thank you. He's also co-authored a handful of other books, including one with Noah Goldstein, who's come here from LA to be with us today. Bob's a well-respected speaker on the topic of ethical influence, and it's a successful company with Bobette to provide training in ethical influence. Bob is now Emeritus Regents Professor, having formally retired, I believe, in 2009, although, if those of you who know his car, who can tell? And I want to get this right, because Bobette defines retirement Bob Cialdini style as working full time but without that pesky paycheck. Bob is still moving. He's had and he's still having an incredible career, and he spent the entirety of it as a faculty member here in our psychology department. Helping to shape the department in important ways, and I think he'd probably say while being shaped by it. So I'm going to stop here. I'm going to pass the baton and the microphone to Doug Kenrick, Bob's first doctoral student, and since Doug returned to ASU, his longtime colleague and friend. Doug.
I'm going to put that on.
Can't do two things at once. That was that easy. Doing good with my technology here, I can tell you. Give me 1 second. Well, that song was released in 1971, which was a kind of a momentous year, a lot to celebrate in that year. That was 51 years ago, as Steve just pointed out. NPR had its first broadcast in 1951. Starbucks opened their first coffee shop in Seattle in 1971. Evel Knievel flew his motorcycle over 19 cars at the Ontario Speedway in 1971. But perhaps of equal historic importance, Bob Cialdini drove his Plymouth Duster across the United States to begin his career as an assistant professor in social psychology here at ASU. I actually started at ASU as a graduate student at the same time, and I was driving out here in a little VW bug, and I have this vague recollection of somebody shooting past me on the interstate in a Plymouth Duster, banging on the steering wheel and singing, I just want to celebrate in a Wisconsin accent. And that was you, right? Yeah. And so arriving at the same time as Bob was kind of a really life-changing stroke of luck for me. I got to take Cialdini's first social psychology class. It was, I didn't realize it was an honor at the time, to tell you the truth. I thought it was just a required course I had to take. If I'm really being honest, this guy didn't look like at least my idea of a rising academic star. In fact, he really looked more like Eric Burdon, who was, Eric Burdon was the lead singer of The Animals. That was this sort of scruffy rock band with bad haircuts that sang, we gotta get out of this place. But you know, despite the fact that Bob didn't look like my prototype of a great scholar, the faculty who I respected at the time said, instead of leaving here and going to study personality somewhere else, they said, no, I should stay here, join this new social program, and work with Cialdini. And they really all said the same thing. Cialdini is going to be famous. He wasn't famous yet, but they were all convinced he was going to be famous. I didn't know why. But I started working with him, and it kind of turned out to be a blast. First study we did, Bob wanted to find out the age at which kids started to find altruism rewarding. And so what we did is we went into an elementary school, and these cute little kids, we made them all get really sad by thinking about their dead dog or something along those lines. And then we gave them little coupons for ice cream and asked them if they would contribute any to the other kids. And in another experiment, poor ASU undergraduates got to watch another ASU undergraduate who was presumably receiving this series of painful electrical shocks. So, you know, those were the good old days in social science. And in those two studies, Bob carried me to my first two publications in JPSP, the Journal of Personality and Social Psych. And they had these clever titles that Bob had made up. The one where we tortured the little kids was called Altruism is Hedonism. And the other one where we scared undergraduates was called Rosier Skies for the Devalued Victim. So in the course of working with Bob, I became increasingly, you know, impressed with his ability to design clever studies, to write papers, to choose the exact words that you would put in a letter to an editor who had rejected your paper to convert that rejection into an acceptance. He was really good at this, and he was especially good at these clever titles. In fact, the story is that Bob would sometimes design a study to match a title that he had made up. He has these titles, you know, like the door in the face technique, basking in reflected glory, when even a penny would help, and so on and on, you know. I began to realize in working with this guy that the people who said that Bob was going to be famous, you know, they were right. In fact, sure enough, I looked online the other night and I saw that he was listed somewhere as one of the 10 most influential living social psychologists. He didn't have a Google page, and no one had been trying to get him to set it up, and he did it wrong. I calculated he had well over 90,000 citations to his work. And there's a book written by a Nobel Prize winning economist, Richard Thaler, in which Thaler refers to Bob as the guru of social influence. And I've seen the New York Times refer to him in the same way. Now, a lot of people who are successful, you know, they fall guilty to self-aggrandizement and self-promotion. But Cialdini personifies instead this term, the Italian term, sprezzatura. Okay, and I looked it up to see, and sprezzatura is this artistic nonchalance. It's a kind of a appearing, you're great to others without seeming like there's any effort, like a Formula Uno driver. Ah, fa niente, facile, you know, it's like it's no big deal, right? And so Bob really does that really well. And Bob has, you know, become so famous around here. There are legends about him, like there's the legend of the baseball scout who almost offered him a professional contract, but then his pen didn't work. And he told Bob, really, you should go to college instead because you're not that good at baseball. And then there's the famous story of how Bob's baseball abilities were turned in, helped him turn into a hero among the Milwaukee garbage men in a story that I would call Cialdini versus the flying garbage dump rat. And my wife, Carol, said, don't tell the details on that one, Doug. Save it for later at the bar, okay? Anyway, despite the sprezzatura, Cialdini has hardly had his success handed to him, as Steve just pointed out. He works still every day. You know, when he came out here, he really is. He's like one of these Harry Potter stories. He started at the bottom. He was, you know, driving this Plymouth Duster. He was living in a, you know, that Duster looked like the, you'd ever see the Dukes of Hazzard, you know, these Appalachian guys driving this old car. That's what this looked like. He looked like straight from Appalachia. And he lived in an apartment complex where, and I'm not lying about this, there were two murders in the apartment complex that Bob lived in. One was a mob hit. And Bob was actually the first on the scene, and I'm also not supposed to bring that up at this point. Okay. So I said nothing. So you might ask, well, how did this working class guy from the garbage dumps of Milwaukee become the guru of social influence? Some of it had to do with the book that Steve mentioned, really. I think that's probably the big thing, this book on the six principles of social influence, which I have actually personally read like four times. And it's about how businessmen and politicians and, you know, religious people kind of convince you to go their way or to part with your money that you wanted to keep in your own pocket. And Cialdini studied this, you know, and his latest edition, which I actually just, he actually speaks the, I'm old, so I don't read books anymore. I now listen to them on audio. And it was great to hear Bob does his latest edition of his book. And he has a new principle called unity in this one, a seventh principle. You know, that's like the old Coke ad, I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect, you know, those multiracial people singing about this, just selling Coke, but, you know, it makes you feel like, you know, wow, we're all in this together. You know, more, even more than the sprezzatura, Bob embodies unity, you know. He, despite the fact that he's had offers from more prestigious places, he's stuck with our team. And in fact, he's made this a more prestigious place, a more prestigious social area, and probably even a more prestigious department. So I was going and looking at all these Google Scholar citations. I saw this long list of people all the way from, you know, NOAA. The people between you and I, you know, there are dozens of them, you know, maybe 100 of them, undergraduates, graduate students, you know, faculty members, some in this room now, whose careers were helped along by this guy driving that beat up old car. And when his fame turned into fortune, what he decided to do is give a lot of it back. Okay, just here, I don't want this. He's, you know, he gave it to the departments, given to the wider society as well. And you know, Dave, my son, asked me, well, what, is there any secret? I said, well, you know, there's a lot of secrets that Bob has, and he's great about sharing. But I thought one thing that struck me about Bob is that there isn't any line. I think the fact that he comes in to work every day, it's not work to him. There's no real line between fun and scientific research to Bob. You know, it's one and the same thing. He gets an intrinsic satisfaction from pursuing ideas, and he really gets a great satisfaction. And if you've ever seen him give a lecture to a group of people, he loves to communicate his ideas. He loves to communicate in writing, and he loves to communicate to a live audience. And he's really, he's better at pitching an idea than he is at pitching a baseball. So he made the right the right decision back then. So Steve, I'm going to close, but Steve and my son Dave said, you know, look, just stick with the nice things, Dad. None of the wise ass shit about the mafia and stuff, you know. But I'm sorry, I have one complaint. So I'm sorry, Steve, and I feel like, okay, maybe this isn't the time to bring it up, and I'm going to bring it up just because, you know, it's something I felt bad about. He taught me a lot about, you know, how to write an article, how to deal with an editor, you know, how to teach and blah, 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 you know. But there's the one thing that he's most well known for. He just refused to teach me. And you're not even knowing what I'm talking about. This is going to jog your memory, Bob. Bob never taught me to do the hustle. And Carol's probably thinking, and a good thing, because, but you know, more seriously, I would say, Bob, it has really, truly, and I'm not just saying this, has been the greatest honor and privilege of my life to work with you, to write books with you, to talk about human nature with you. You're not only an internationally revered guru and a grand master of designing studies with clever titles, and you know, kind of the modern answer to Fred Astaire on the dance floor. You're also a good human being, and I do mean that sincerely. I calculated this morning that there are 18,615 days in 51 years, and I just wanted to celebrate another day of basking in your reflected glory. So, Bob, thanks.
Actually, Doug, can you come back here for a sec?
What's up?
I just need your physical. Just stand. No. I don't want you. I don't want you in the camera. Just right there. Stop. Up. Thank you. We're gonna do the unveiling of the installation here. After which, a little bit more description and a little bit more stuff. So, Doug, if you could just help me lift this and walk it down the hallway a bit. The physical instantiation, although not the deep conceptual instantiation, of the Robert B. Cialdini Social Psychology Laboratories. That's good. Just against the wall. Yeah. Thanks. Okay. I think you can also maybe see it on some of the other screens over there for those who don't have an angle here. Bob, can you? Okay, now you go that way. There we go. All right. So, Bob, if you stand next to me over here. I just want to give a really quick tour for those of you who don't have a good angle on this. Underneath the naming placard is a list of the social psychology laboratories. Now, I have to say, as an aside, that as we were thinking about doing this and listing the laboratories and thinking about how cool that is, we've decided that we're going to install directories to all the labs in the department, moving on down the hallway, so that folks who visit our department can really see all the very cool things and the wide breadth of all we do. And as in so many ways, trying to think like Bob has led us to an idea that better captures our whole and how we are all linked in community, or what Bob would call, and what Doug referred to as unity. Yeah, so, all right. Next to that, for those again who don't have a good angle, is the essence, I think, of this installation. It's a touchscreen display that enables passersby to explore different chapters describing Bob and his contributions. And again, those of you who don't have a good angle, some of you might be able to see it on the screen over there. I don't know. There's a chapter, a video on Bob's research on full cycle psychology, ethical influence, the secret of Bob's success, Bob and ASU, who is Bob Cialdini, and on giving back. What I'm going to do right now is, the screen's on a continuous scroll right now, but what you're able to do is that you're able to click on any of these and watch everything is, what's the word for that?
Transcribe,
captured, captioned, whatever, next to it. I'll be able to click and sort of see what a bunch of people very close to Bob and who care a lot about Bob and are fans and highly respect Bob have to say about Bob. So what we're going to do now is that we're just going to play the overview. It's a little bit like a trailer of what's to come elsewhere. In order to get this right and get the sound right, Rob and I are going to try to do something magical here. Oh, Rob, I need the clicker. We have the clicker?
Oh, you. Oh, I thought you were going to touch the screen.
Well, so I am going to touch the screen and unmute at the same time.
All right. Well, yeah. Okay. So.
Bob Cialdini is unquestionably one of the greatest social psychologists of the last century.
It's impossible to interact with Bob without being energized about new questions.
Bob Cialdini is a great observer.
He saw things that you saw or will see, but he recognized this is an event, this is an effect, something is going on here.
He's always had a real skill and a talent for connecting the science to stuff that real people, even if they're not academics, actually care about.
Bob has an incredibly creative mind.
Who would think to do an experiment in the petrified wood forest or in hotel bathrooms? But Bob.
Future generations of psychologists will benefit and take inspiration from the approach that Bob uses to developing research ideas and ultimately studying them.
He liked to do what he called full cycle social psychology.
Bob's work represents the very best of social psychology, combining both basic theory and conceptual development, along with an important application to the real world.
Perhaps the most important of Bob Cialdini's work focuses on how much we're influenced by social norms.
Bob's book, Influence, is the Bible in the science of influence and persuasion.
It's such a powerful subject and has so many implications. It's just gained and gained over time.
But Bob is so darn good that you couldn't even get jealous of him.
Not only is he a world-class psychologist, he is a world-class human being.
He cares about the people around him and he cares about the big issues.
Bob is unconditionally generous. It doesn't matter if he sees you as somebody who will ever be in a position to return the favor.
I have always been impressed with his integrity, the way that he conducts his life and his business.
He always has a phenomenon or a datum ready to go for almost any issue. But at the same time at a party, he's a blast.
I remember going to a conference once and seeing Bob doing the hustle.
I think he's an amazing dancer, even now. Of course, our grandkids laugh at him, but.
Well, Bob's car is another thing.
He was driving that Mustang in the late 1980s when I was a graduate student.
I know. And that's the only car I've ever seen him drive.
He had that car when I first got here, and it seemed old then.
He told me that the only reason he even took a psychology class was there was a girl he had a crush on. And by the end of the semester, he had forgotten her, but he'd fallen in love with psychology.
When he was working his way through college, actually worked as a garbage man out on the trucks.
But another career he almost considered is...
Is it Jimmy?
a Major League Baseball player.
I was offered a contract to play minor league baseball. This scout, I still remember him, his name was Bunny Brief. His pen wouldn't work. And while we were walking, he said, let me ask you something, kid. Are you good enough at school to go to college, to get accepted? I said, yes. Go to school, kid. He just took the contract.
I think that baseball scout, for the wonderful gift he gave the rest of the world.
I would love to buy him the biggest steak dinner, any place he wanted.
He has changed people's lives through doing something that he loves to do, the research.
When people find out that Bob Cialdini was my mentor, the most common response is, Bob Cialdini is my hero.
Everybody talks about Bob Cialdini behind his back as, you know, a true scholar and gentleman.
It's really inspiring to look at his work.
I've been influenced immensely by Bob's work.
Without Bob Cialdini, I would not be a psychologist.
Bob has been a role model for the entire field, and I count myself as incredibly lucky to have been able to work with and be mentored by Bob from the very beginning of my career.
He is everything that we hope to be as academics and, frankly, as people.
The Robert B. Cialdini Social Psychology Laboratories will serve as an inspiration for all of our students and faculty in generations to come, and also give due appreciation and respect to a man who has had a tremendous career and influence on ASU.
Who sat for interviews, who sent in their own tapes.
Perhaps the most
Okay. Take this from me, please. Okay. All of whom are great fans of Bob, including some of the things move quickly. You can see, get much more when you're looking at the rest of the chapters here, and we'll just let this scroll. Two Nobel laureates, very well-known, highly respected, stunningly good scientists and public intellectuals, former students and colleagues, and even a multi-billionaire who's not all that popular in Santa Barbara these days. But, and now one last expression of gratitude. I'm proud that my own lab is now part of the Robert B. Cialdini Social Psychology Laboratories. And so on behalf of our psychology family, thank you for all your contributions and all the many forms they've taken. Thank you.
Well,
thank you so much for that. I didn't know that one was coming. You know, in the speaker's business, there's a joke that speakers are supposed to say when there's been a long and effusive introduction of them. And the joke is, well, I've heard of speakers who need no introduction. Now apparently we have an introduction that needs no speaker. It's not a joke here. That's not a joke. I mean, I'm almost speechless, almost don't know what to say. But that's never stopped me before from speaking when I don't know what I'm talking about. So I actually have some notes here that I plan to say. And let me begin with the question of why I'm here today. And the answer applies both to the reason I chose to come to ASU and the reason I chose to stay at ASU. Despite, like many of you, having other offers from universities with reputations that my parents and their neighbors would find as better than ASU's, But one big reason I came here is, one fundamental reason, is there's a time in your life when you stop doing things to impress your parents and their neighbors. You start doing them for your own reasons. So what were those reasons? First are two seemingly trivial reasons. Palm trees. I grew up in Wisconsin. Right. The only time I ever saw a palm tree was watching the Tournament of Roses parade on New Year's Day. Right. And now I had a chance to have a palm tree in my backyard. It was seismic. Right. The other was amazing Mexican food. I'd lived in a lot of places, including New York, before. I never tasted Mexican food like this. I mean, a good chili relleno or cheese enchilada, you couldn't beat it. So those two things were, I know they're trivial, but I'm not going to discount their impact. The other two reasons, much more determinative. The first was the people. The people here, from the first moment I stepped on campus and the other two social psychologists who were here, John Rich and Sandy Braver, were warm. They made me feel as accepted and welcomed as I possibly could be. Do you know that there was no job talk? They didn't require a job talk. Just talk to people, get your sense of the vision you have for your research, how you would fit with this place and so on, immediately. And they both showed me how rigorous they were as social and behavioral scientists, and I felt, okay, I can fit in here. And then we can talk about subsequent faculty who came after I decided to join the program. We didn't have a social psychology PhD granting program yet for a couple of years, but we started acquiring other faculty members, Darwin Linder. Nancy Eisenberg came as a social psychologist, right? Steve West came as a social psychologist. And
good.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. And together, they raised the average IQ of the university by about 10 points. And then other people, Doug was one of those people who came back and did the same thing. All of the new faculty members, I felt equally impressed by. Imagine the kid in the candy shop kind of feeling I had. There were all these very impressive minds, all of these people who were ready to provide counsel and perspective and advice on my work and feedback. You know, they were sounding board, eager, and all I had to do was reach out, and there they were. Like, right? Penny candy, they were right there. And so why would I ever trade that for someplace else? Another kind of version of the people was graduate students. I have been blessed to have outstanding graduate students. Now, this wasn't always the case. Back in those first years, when we didn't have a social psychology program, we would get people who kind of migrated in from other places where they didn't have good fits, or they had gotten a degree and then they decided, well, when you folks do get a PhD program, if I work with faculty members, maybe I can get a leg up. And there was one such guy who was working with me. He expressed an interest in some of the work I was doing at the time, and we did a study together. I'm not going to mention his name. He's not among our group anymore. And we had collected this data. It was a big data set, and the data were in time to take a look, time to analyze the data, and he was in charge of that. And I said, so, when are we going to get the data? And he said, well, it's going to be a while because I have some friends coming in for the weekend that I have to host. And besides, I have to study for an exam early next week. So it's probably going to be a while. And I said to myself, the data reveal, and you're putting something in front of the data reveal? The data reveal is everything. That's what we're here for. That's what we're excited about. That's what we're enthusiastic about, right? The data are the bomb. You don't do anything before you look at the data, right? And I said to myself about this guy, you'd be better off selling shoes, right? than doing this. It's just the wrong job for you, right? If you don't, okay. But as soon as we got the PhD program rolling, we started getting really impressive graduate students. Doug was my first PhD. And I remember saying to myself about him, wow, not only does this guy have an engine, he has high test intellectual horsepower to drive that engine. This is definitely a good match. And then people started coming who were equally impressive. And through it all was all of this sense of, why would I go anywhere else when I have everything, not only that I need, that I aspire to, right here. Why roll the dice and go someplace where there might be a sour intellectual environment or political environment, or whatever it was? It was silly to think about it. Although I have to say, I did get an offer or two that made me break out in a rash all over my back before I decided no. Right? Okay. So that's one thing. One reason. Here's the last reason, besides the people. The freedom that this place afforded me to do my work from the start. At the very beginning, when I got here, ASU had decided, and the psychology department had decided, they were not going to use the model of bringing in high prestige people who were going to come to Arizona and retire, all right, after a few years. No, they were going to start from the bottom. They were going to give their assistant professors what they needed to bring their ideas to the fore, the laboratory space, the equipment, the funds, and so on. They came to us, the assistant professors. Mm-hmm. And you know those fellow colleagues that I was talking about who were there to provide, not just at the beginning, but throughout, counsel and perspective and advice? No guardrails. There were no guardrails for me, telling me, no, that's too risky. Don't do that. You've got a tenure decision come back. No. Go ahead, write your book. Take 2 years off and write this book, research this book, write this book. If you look at my vita, I have a pretty good publication right now. Then there are two blank years. I know what those years are, what I was doing those years. I was researching and writing this book, right? And I didn't get a squawk from anybody telling me not to do that, right? When I was in school, I was a pretty good student in elementary school, but I was a better high school student than I was an elementary school student, and I was a better college student than high school student, and I was a better graduate student than college student, and I think I was a better professional than graduate student. And I think the reason is, as I moved up each of those steps, I got more freedom, more degrees of freedom to do what I want, to choose the factors that I wanted to study, to decide what I thought was most important, and to investigate it in the ways that I wanted to investigate it. No one knows? Hotel rooms, right? Hotel rooms. You know, we We change what you say on a little card that's in the hotel room somewhere asking people to hang up their towels. And I remember the first time I ever saw one of those cards that asked me to do this for the environment. You know how you see signs around on buildings? This space for rent or this space for lease. I remember looking at that card and saying, this space for test, this space available for test. What do you say on this card? Look, it's right available to us. We can just get the cooperation of the manager. Noah again knows how that worked. Wasn't easy. Get the cooperation, change that stuff, and then we look to see how many towels are. I mean, this was the sort of stuff that I didn't get any pushback on at all. That freedom that this place gave me, I don't think like any other place I had interviewed and gotten accepted, this place offered it to a young, budding social psychologist. Okay, so let's ask this question. How do I feel about this? This honor. I don't think there's an English word that applies. But I've been in psychology enough to know the Yiddish word for it. It's kvelling. To kvell is to burst with pride and satisfaction in a particular moment at something, right? And this, a while ago, I saw a TV commercial, and I started to see other versions of that commercial recently. Here's the storyline. A young person encounters an older version of himself. In this case, it's a guy, right? Decades longer after, at the end of his career, right? And the young guy says to the older one, so how's it going to work out? How am I going to end my career? Is it going to be a success? Am I going to be happy? Right. And here's my version of the ad. The camera zooms in on these two versions of Cialdini. And the young guy, and the old guy takes the young one to this sign and shows him the Robert B. Cialdini Social Psychology Labs, right? And when you see the close-up of the young guy, he's gobsmacked. He's totally astounded, down to a little run of spittle out of the side of his mouth. But you focus on the old Cialdini, the old guy, and he's cavilling. He's cavilling. Right? That's how I feel about this. And there's one more thing. There's so many people I need to thank here, and it's a shame that there are so many. I know I'll forget them, but I just want to thank everybody who's been associated with putting this together. Steve, you and Erica, and David and Rob, all of the people who've been doing this for me. But there's somebody else, Bobette Gordon. She's not here because of stomach flu that prevents her from leaving the house with alacrity. And also, she didn't want to give it to anybody else. And here's the thing about Bobette. People say to me, so why did you get together with somebody named Bobette? Is that because you'll never be able to forget her name? I mean, you'll easily remember her name? No. That's not it. It's another thing about her name. Her middle name is Joy. Bobette Joy Gordon. And there's onomatopoeia there. She's been my helpmate. She's been my teammate. She's been my playmate. She's been my soulmate. And I wouldn't be here without Babette Joy Gordon. Now, I wouldn't be selling shoes, but I wouldn't be here. So thank you very much for all of this.
Thank you, Bob. Thanks, everyone. And let's have fun.